Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Due to a request that was posted after we did the Kanye production video, today we're gonna be doing a beat in the style of Pete Rock. Pete Rock is a living legend. He's been blessing our ears with ridiculous beats for years now. Let's jump into it. In an interview I came across with Pete Rock, he said, "I'll take a snare and a kick from the very beginning of a record. I got my best kicks and snares that way. Rock records especially, so let's do that very thing." And in that interview he goes on to say, "Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath, Kiss. Yeah man, Kiss got drums. So how about we sample some Kiss?" I pulled in this record called Going Blind that I found, and check out the drums in the very beginning of the record. I know I can do something with that. So here's what we'll do. Just grab a drum rack. I hope it's not a dumb rack. In our blank drum rack, I'm gonna press where I want my kick to go, and you can see that the yellow icon lights up here, and that is C3, as you'd expect. So I'm just gonna drag our sample on there. Now we're just gonna isolate the kick. Dang, that tail sounds kinda cool. This is the reason I'm using the classic mode on simpler instead of one shot, is that I can just bring the sustain all the way. We'll bring it down to about there. So you just get a hint of the tail. Gives it like some dimension, but it's not like a gated reverb kick or something. So I think that'll be a good foundation. I do want to add another sample on top so we can beef it up a bit. It's all about the layers. I went ahead and grabbed this little kick that I made that has, you know, a lot of low end information in it. See, it just adds that bottom end to it. Pete Rock likes to do the shuffled kick thing. You know, it's that boom bap style. So, you know, the da-doom, doom, da-doom, doom. So there's a couple of different ways that you can set that up. Like, for example, you can go like this and use the same kick. Oh, I played that terribly. If this is your shuffled kick here, this one, you can turn it way down and go like that. I prefer, though, at this fast tempo of 95, so you don't have to go on a pad really fast. I'm just gonna hold Alt, and I'm gonna drag another kick to the pad just behind C3, so that would be B2. Where's B2? Right here. And we'll call this shuff kick or something. Then what I do is I open up the mixer, turn the shuffled kick down by, I don't know, say 15, and then when you are recording in your drums, that way you don't have to worry so much about getting the velocities right, and you can do them faster. Next, let's move on to the snare. I don't really like the idea of using a flammed snare, you know, as our main snare sound, so I'm going to pull a snare from a different song. I found this record called Phases by the Cannonball Adderley Quintet. It sounds like this. I thought that snare sounded dope and something that we could use, so let's try that one. Once again, I want my snare to be on, this is D3, so I'm gonna grab this sample, put it on D3. So once again, just moving the flags around until I find an isolated snare that I kinda like. Ooh. Can hear that snare has some good like character to it, but it needs a little more like snap. When Pete Rock was asked if he layers his drums, he said, "Sometimes I do. Sometimes I'll use two snares or a tambourine on top of a snare just to make it hit harder." Let's make ours hit harder and add another snare on top of what we've got here already. I pulled in another Kiss song. I had to. But check out what this song called Charisma sounds like. I wanna use that snare on top of what we've got. So let's go back to our drum rack here. So what I'm gonna do here is select our snare down here at the bottom, and I'm gonna press Command G to put it in a group so that we can layer two snares on top of one another. And I'm gonna drag our Kiss Charisma here, and we'll call this Snare 2. Keep it simple. Stupid. Oh, Kiss, you like that? Okay. Probably this one here looks good. Adjust our flags. Maybe that one, we'll fade it out. And see how this sounds together with the original snare. And it's still holding on for too long, but instead of tightening up the flags more, I'm gonna raise the pitch and then cut off the beginning more. Oh, and if you wanna get rid of that annoying setting where it changes what you're working on based on the pad that you're hitting, just come over here to the bottom left of the part of the drum rack and hit this little arrow. It's called auto select. Turn that off. I always turn it off. All right, so here's before. And after. It just gives it that bite that I wanted. Now we gotta get the hat going. Sometimes it's good to use the hat from the kit that you sampled the snare from because it tends to sound a little more natural that way. So let's go ahead and snag a hat from the first percussive section of the Charisma sample from Kiss that we pulled in. And my hat I want to put on, let's put it on the E key. So I can hear that the hats we have to choose from in this sample are either the hats that are at the same time as the kick or as the snare. And if you have a choice between those two, always go with the kick because you can always high pass filter out the kick part of the hat, if that makes sense. It's really hard to get rid of the snare once it's in there with the hat. So let's find one here. We'll add a filter. And then, you know, my favorite thing to do, just drag the fade out all the way up, choke it. And adjust the fade in time, say 2 milliseconds. I also want to pitch this hat up because it's just sitting a little low for me. So let's push it up a little bit. There we go. All right, let's mute our samples and get a little Pete Rock groove going. All right, now let's get to the sampling. Pete Rock is pretty impressively diverse with like what he chooses to sample, but I did notice a few patterns in what he likes to do. A lot of his beats feature a chopped up piano, and he's also mentioned in the past that jazz musicians I give a lot of respect to because listening to it, you're like, how does someone write such a thing? So what we're gonna do is hunt for some jazz piano to sample. One of my favorite jazz pianists is Bill Evans. It's like a sample gold mine, I'm serious. I picked out a record called Gary's Theme for us today. Here's what that sounding beautiful. This little snippet that I have, all I'm going to do is make a new MIDI track by pressing Command Shift T and then drag the clip onto the blank MIDI track, which creates a sampler for us and we can start slicing and dicing. Obviously this sample is a little on the slow side, so my plan is to head over to the controls tab at the top right and just go down to the where the, you can change the transposition or the key of the sample. I'm just gonna speed this up. See if we can get some quicker chops together. And then head back to the sample tab, and then on the left here, where you can choose between classic, one shot, and slice, my plan is to use slice mode so that we can play in the chops with our piano. And you can see that the way that it's sliced up the sample right now, the chops are really condensed together. And in order to fix that, all you need to do is, you know, bring down the sensitivity, and then that will spread out the chops a little bit better. Let's see if we can find something that we like here. Okay, check this out. Oh, and I didn't record it. Okay, this is why you always record. I love that chromatic bass line at the end. That'll be cool. A big feature that you'll notice in Pete Rock's beats is that he uses like this wah sound. And about that very sound, he said, one thing about me that I used to always get from Tip was like, yo, what's that wah-wah sound that you do? And it was a certain EQ I had in Green Street. I had everybody thinking it was a wah-wah pedal you hook up to the sample or something. No, it was an EQ. Which means that he got that sound from manually adjusting like a resonant low-pass filter or something similar on an analog EQ. Let's say that we wanted to use a sound like that over our sample chops. What I would do is pull open Ableton's auto filter. You can see this drop down, it gives us these analog filtering options. And I'm gonna use the LFO so you can hear what the filter is doing. So now with a low pass filter sound like this, it sounds cool, but you can hear that there's a lot of low end mud happening. So instead of EQing all that mud out, it's kind of a good opportunity to use a feature of autofilter that you might not have used before, and it is the morph filter. It's kind of a combination of different filters. It's really cool. When we move this morph knob, you can see it alternates between a low pass filter, a band pass, and then sort of a high pass filter, and everywhere in between. So let's start by changing our circuit type from clean to OSR, which is more of the analog thing I was talking about. And then what I'm gonna do here is move the morph up until it just cuts out that low end mud I was talking about, but still gives us that nice wah sound that we're after. But we're not going to use an LFO. Remember, we're going to do this by hand just like Pete Rock does. So take the amount all the way down on the LFO. In order to set this up to do manually, I'm not going to drag the cutoff up and down with my mouse. I'm actually going to use this MPK Mini that I have. So all I'm going to do is press Command M, and that will bring up the MIDI mappings mode in Ableton. And you can see all these controls turn blue, and that is basically Ableton telling you that all of these controls can be assigned to the MIDI controller. We want to control our filter frequency, so I'm gonna select that, and you can see that it has those little brackets around it to tell you that that's selected. Now I'm gonna move this first knob on my MPK Mini. Then you can see that it says 1/1, meaning that the first knob is controlling our filter frequency. So now if I move it up and down, you can see we now have control over it. Super easy. So let's make use of that and record in some manual wahs. Now, just before we get recording, what you need to do is go up to the top and where you see the plus button, that's called the MIDI arrangement overdub button. Select that, and that will allow us to put Ableton in record mode without recording over the MIDI notes that we've already got here, which is what our sample chops are being played with. And then also select this automation arm button, and that will allow us to record in the changes that we make to the cutoff frequency with our MIDI controller. So let's record a few passes and find something that we like here. All right, so here, this is what we ended up with. Check this out. If you'd like to see the automation that you actually wrote in, there's a couple ways you can do that. The first way is to just come over here on the right underneath your track name, and where it says none, just click and press auto filter frequency, and you can see what was written out. The other way that you can do it is just right click the parameter that you're interested in on the auto filter, for example, and press show automation, and it'll do the same thing. Another pattern in Pete Rock sampling is that he takes little snippets from multiple records and then puts them in the same beat, just like Primo does, if you remember or watched our video on DJ Premier. I thought it would be cool to add a little guitar sample. So I heard this Curtis Mayfield record called Think, and it sounds like this. So let's find something that we can take from that little sample here. I'm gonna bring this guitar sample down here. Just the audio clip. I'm thinking we mess with that part right there. Let's see what we can do with that. Oh yeah, yeah, right there, right there, right there. Ooh. Then we'll repeat it. Just nice and simple. Maybe we can actually drag out this second clip. I think that needs, this first part needs to go down a couple of semitones. Let's see. Ooh, that's cool, that's cool. Okay, Let's add one more sample here, and we're gonna make it a little more interesting, but we're not gonna make it too crowded. This is something that Pete Rock has talked about in the past, that you gotta keep it simple. Pete Rock does like to incorporate a lot of horn samples in his beats, so I'm gonna snag some from the funk master himself, James Brown. I pulled in this record called Blues and Pants, if you're familiar. Ridiculous. Oh, deep in the pocket. Baby. That part right there. Okay, so this could be a little turnaround to bring us back to the repeat of the beat. The beat repeat. So let's put it here. And then once the beat repeats, I want to make this kind of crazy and put like a lot of delays on it. So let's bring up a filter delay. Let's change the delay time to be quarter note. And then let's get rid of the snare at the end there. Oh yeah. Listen how long that delay goes. This is definitely coming along. And now it's high time for us to add the bass. Pete Rock's bass lines are awesome and legendary, and he really likes to use these like subby bass sounds. I'm gonna use the sound that we went over making last week called Essential Hip Hop Bass. And I use Serum for this, so we're just gonna pull open Serum. So if you wanna know how we built this sound, make sure you tune into the episode last week called Essential Hip Hop Bass. So here's what it sounds like. Let me arm it. So let's add some bass here. Very important to remember, I forgot to do this just a second ago. Turn off the MIDI arrangement overdub button, because when you loop record, it will keep the previous take and it'll get all jumbled. So let's try that again. I'm just gonna copy this bass through. Oh, and one final little detail that I added in there. I was playing around with the chops and I came up with this, adding up this little extra piano bit here. So here it is. Thought it sounded cool. Really short, just this is like. And then when the bass comes in, to add a little spice to the beat. So let's take a listen to what we got here. There it is. That's what we ended up with for Pete Rock today. If you guys do have any requests for any producers you want me to cover in the future, please do let me know down in the comments below. And as always, happy music making. See you next time.